Production costs for Rare Visions and Roadside Revelations have been paid for in part by Sprint, committed to the community, connecting you to the world.
Welcome to a show about things you can see without going far, and a lot of them are free. If you thought there was nothing in the old heartland, you ought to hit the black op with these fools in a van. Look out, they're driving hard, checking out art in their own backyard. Randy does the steering so he won't hurl. Mike's got the map, such a man of the world. That's Don with the camera, kinda heavy on his shoulder. And that giant ball of tape, it's a world record holder. Look out, they're driving hard, checking out art in their own backyard. Look out, they're driving hard, checking out the world in their own backyard. Checking out the world in their own backyard.
Go to another adventure.
Dear TV mailbag, what are Dells and why does Wisconsin have them? Hi, Don the camera guy here, and I can pretty much predict that will be another question those two producers with whom I travel will leave unanswered. They're more intent on finding unusual art, and I know they say that art is where you find it, but first you have to find it. We're here just outside Baraboo, looking for something made by someone named Dr. Evermore that we were told lies just behind this surplus yard.
I guess it's here, but hey, this is just a junkyard. We've got junkyards back in Missouri.
Don, are you dissing me too?
Who told you about this, Pam?
My jaw is dropping.
Hail Bob.
Well, clearly the good doctor has not been wasting his time on house calls. This is incredible, and how can you not like a guy who immediately puts two TV weasels right to work?
Well, this is a shoebox, that one is. Most of these are spider bites. I like birds and bugs.
Pre-existing shapes and forms, where they lose their original identity and become something else. That's a sumo wrestler there, you see? See, these are sea puppies over here. These cotton pickers, they're looking at me, you know. The quality is good because it's all welded inside, outside, and it's all heavy material, ain't no flim-flam stuff. It's the real stuff. And I don't alter any parts. I was an industrial wrecker. Yeah, I took 350 major wrecking jobs, you know, power plants and stuff down. And this is, you wear different hats at different times of your life. So now I'm working in a fantasy world of Dr. Evermore.
It is all pretty amazing back here, but that big thing, the centerpiece, the Forevertron, perhaps the heaviest sculpture ever made by a single individual, is the most amazing of all.
You see that spiral staircase right there behind this unit?
Yep.
Okay, when you're ready to go to heaven, you climb the spiral staircase and get up to the top and crank those cranks up there. That ball goes up, signaling to everybody on the ground, you're ready to highball it to heaven. This generating equipment here generates the magnetic force that goes to the magnetic holding chamber over there, because this is a blend of magnetic energy and lightning energy in order to get this egg off the ground. You know that. That other piece in the back there I'm working on is a overlord master control, which steers this gyro, which is a little baby egg, and then it directs the other egg into the heavens. It's a catalyst because it's like a magnet. People just come from all over the world here.
I'll bet.
Was there a big blueprint that you worked from? You spread it all out on the ground and said, okay, here's what I need, here's how we're going to do it?
No way. There's nothing here that we ever follow any rules of thumb that they teach you in college, because you lose all the energy that you would to do something, so we just go with the flow. This is a bug that is 46 to 50 foot long when it's all put together, and it's called the juicer.
This piece fits over that piece,
that's right?
That's the connection inside.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, so when you say it's a juicer, you don't mean a fruit juicer. You mean like an electric juicer.
Yeah.
To juice this thing.
Yeah. So we got lightning coming in on this thing. Yeah. We got this big juicing bug.
Yeah.
And we got bipolar dynamos. And then we got a big generating plant. We can't fail on this now. You know that.
I want to be here when it goes.
Yeah,
too.
Yeah.
Because I've had it with this TV thing.
Yeah.
I got to tell you, man, this stuff is for the birds.
Well, you want birds? There's more birds over there. This band will play and will celebrate the happenings of the egg going into the heavens. You can't pucker right or something. These birds and the bugs all have historic tools in them. Some of the heads are better than the other ones. I got a lot of real good heads in them. Those are sea cats out there, and they're looking over here to see if they can come in here and take a bite of one of these birds.
Is using the stuff important to you?
Yes, it is. Very, very important. That's why we go at such a speed. We use up as much stuff as we can. There's probably 700-800 little sculptures leave here and are adopted by other people each year.
It don't eat much. Well, they don't let me eat much either.
And I am happy to say that one of those will be going home with me. It should fit nicely in the back with the big ball of tape and that rising tide of debris that pretty much defines our life on the road.
You guys keep powering on!
We're powering.
Well, if it makes you feel any better about how little you're getting done, the doctor does get help powering on from his wife and teenage son. And by the way, part of his previous life was spent building things at the infamous House on the Rock. One of those big, close to the Dells deals that we're going to pass up. However, the traffic out here is harder to avoid.
Come on, Randy, pass these nine cars.
Should I make a daring move? What do you think?
Yeah.
This might be the place.
I'll record it for insurance purposes.
Randy is a very good driver, which is why, and this is truly amazing, he's never had a ticket. However, in our excitement to see Wisconsin's largest tree, and you can only imagine the competition, his streak may have been broken.
I've never had a ticket, Mike.
What did you do this time?
Here, see your driver's license, please.
Oh, man.
Going a little fast through town.
How fast is fast?
55 and a 25.
That's a little fast.
It's a little ridiculous.
Does the fact that we're here to see the tree get me off? We have this big ball of videotape? You probably get that excuse all the time, right?
Yeah, I've had that three times today already.
The shame of it all.
I've never had a ticket. Can I pay with my library card? What would Mike's mom say?
What I did, I wrote you a warning ticket. So anybody that comes to see the biggest tree in Wisconsin, Montello, the Granite City, should get a warning. Need help with that giant ball?
Yeah.
Yeah, could you load that up for me?
No problem.
Thank you. You guys are the best. I'm buying tickets to the policeman's ball.
That was a close call. I was thinking lawyers and lineups and 8x10 glossies, but I guess Jack Frost won't be nipping at our heels as we motor out of Mondello. Now, when it comes to the wonders of Wisconsin, I don't suppose anyone knows more than Lisa Stone. After all, she wrote the book on it. At least it's grottos and gardens of concrete. So when she's not leading tours and teaching classes, she occasionally gets back home to her grassroots art-filled yard just up the way in Neshkaroon.
That's by Ernie Hansen.
That's what I was gonna say.
From Kansas, yeah. Well, I love the fact that Ernie, you know, is really mechanically inclined, but he did not care to make it really tight and manufactured looking. He just wanted it to work. We don't have a date for this. We just heard early 20s, but it was made by a fellow named Jacob Baker, who was a house builder and first made some tinier houses. One is up on posts. And we found a star that he had made, very beautiful star, and then this house, and that's all we know of his work.
I just love some of the little pieces in here.
Yeah.
These little elephants are...
And they're maybe 10 of everything or more, but it's one of the more dense things of this type. I just love it. It's about home.
There does seem to be a huge amount of this work in Wisconsin. Any
there is.
Theories on why there's so much here or anything you've discovered?
Yeah, actually, after traveling around and looking at the sites and hearing all the theories, like the winters are long. Well, the winters are long all over the world in certain northern climates. But I really think that because of the presence of these two monumental grotto environments, the Grotto of the Redemption in West Bend and then the Dickeyville Grotto, people saw it or them and went home and started working in that way. Well, and that's, you know, very strong tradition all over Europe, and many of the builders are either first or second generation European immigrants.
In fact, one such place, the Grotto Garden and Wonder Cave in Rudolph, is just an hour or so to the north.
It's my favorite.
Lisa wished she could come along, but she couldn't. Still, knowing how much we like free stuff, she did offer to share some of those bonus products she'd just gotten at the market.
I know we can use this.
Oh, I know you can use that, boy, hey.
No doubt about who came out on the best end of this deal. So while Smokey wreaked havoc with his cholesterol count, we enjoyed the ride to Rudolph, a small town just outside Stevens Point, where the populace did seem unusually glad to see us. The Grotto Gardens are tucked back here behind this church and school. All part of the project one Father Wagner started more than 60 years ago. Ably carried on for many more years by his protege, Edmund Rybicki.
This was a farmer's cornfield when they started. There was nothing here. There was just rocks and dirt. And then they built a building and started building and building and building and building and then Edmund, he kind of got out of hand.
He planted trees all over the place and then started hauling this very unusual kind of rock that is pretty much only found in that area of Wisconsin. It's called Dawson rock, and I'm not a geologist, but it's part volcanic, and then it has to do with chemical weathering, and it's just absolutely wonderful. So it looks like all this rock just heaved itself out of the ground and just formed these organic structures.
What they would do is they'd get the big ones, you know, you got the big ones, and then you cemented them in, okay, and then you add the medium size in there, you know, and then you let that dry, and then you add the little ones, so that basically when you're done, you can't see any cement. He wanted to have color and you know, not just, and not too gaudy, he wanted the real nature feeling. You see the please register, actually when you stand back farther, you can see it with the shells. This is a good example of the shells, the glass, and the statues are Carrara marble. So when he was traveling, he'd find out where to go and what to do and who to send to. So when he'd get a little money, send for a statue. This is the home for wayward things, you know. This is the home of plants that get too tall, fish that get too big, perennials that get to be a real nuisance. And it all blends in, and then we give things out. So it's a give and take.
Is that lad catching mosquitoes down there?
Absolutely.
These guys loved nature to a degree that is really uncommon now. They love natural things. If a tree fell down, they'd use it. It would become part of it.
When you come here, you have this a warm feeling. You know, you feel good about yourself. And someone often said, well, why don't you go and put a fence around and charge to come in? But that's not what it's meant to be. It's meant to be for anybody and everybody.
Souvenirs.
Of course, when it's open, you can always drop a few bucks at the gift shop, or just two bits if you prefer to see Wisconsin in miniature.
Give me a quarter, Dad, will you?
Can we get a receipt for that?
So sure, you put the quarter in, and what happens?
Push in, and it stays on for quite a while. I even got the key. I can open the door.
Oh, look at that.
It's called the Vigi.
But the real treat here, we have been told, is Father Wagner's Wonder Cave. Worth the nominal price of admission many times over. So I guess it's time to stop wondering and dive right in.
This humbles you. You have to bend down to go in.
Don, you go.
Get humble first.
You're not going to believe it. But it started out, the Wonder Cave took them 35 years to build. The entire cave is above ground. You will not believe it. You feel like you're going into the depths of the earth and this labyrinth, and it seems like it goes on for miles. It's a fifth of a mile. And the amazing thing is that it was built without a plan at all. It's entirely organic, and they built it from the ground up.
Now there's a second story here.
Oh, yeah.
It's a two-story cave.
And it acts like a cave, it sounds like a cave, it feels like a cave. It's dripping water and it's cold and it's beautiful, and they have all this piped in religious music. And it's this funny combination of this really wonderful rock work, which is remarkably done. And then Father Rybicki made most of the artwork that's in there, and they use stock statuary and so forth, and there's a funny contrast, but the experience is wonderful. And then you end up on top of the grotto. If you're thinking of the grottos as kind of a microcosm of a, you know, a natural place, an interior cave and an exterior mountain, it's pretty amazing.
This place really does have bats and batters, but my batteries are starting to give out. Then again, I figure if by now you aren't convinced that the Wonder Cave is one of a kind, all the energizers in Wisconsin probably won't turn the tide.
Play ball!
So I rest my case, among other things, and we will power on in the morning.
Hold that up there by the windshield so the people can see the silhouette of the bee.
Those skeeters last night were about that size, weren't they?
Those are the biggest mosquitoes I've ever seen.
Bloodsucking vermin.
No kidding, you know, it took me a chisel to get them off the windshield this morning.
They have a saying up here, it's not raining, it's just mosquitoes crying.
Now, if anyone should be crying, it would probably be me, since no matter what the conditions are like, those producers stay inside and keep producing while it's me that draws the outdoor duty. See what I mean?
This is the biggest petting zoo I've ever seen.
I'm thinking those guys in that movie said it best. We don't need no stinking badgers. But I guess the point is supposed to be that animals are on our agenda today. In fact, just past Warsaw, outside Annawah, Wilbert Ben has been gathering them up from all corners of the world to come together in his own backyard.
We went back to visit my folks in Canada. While over there, he went to a big zoo, and he saw all these animals and how he liked that real well. So he says when he gets back, that's what he's going to start.
It's not just having the lions and tigers that's noteworthy here. Wilbert actually taught himself to train those big cats in his own little arena, which he decorated with art from his own chainsaw.
How did you know how to make that?
Well, I measured my head. I made it by scale. And then I had a Dremel tool set. I put the wrinkles and stuff in.
Wilbert also does a little wood burning to pass the time, and speaking of heat.
First, a little breakfast. Well, I can hold fire in my mouth for 5 minutes if I have to. I was 15 years old when I started that. That's why the girls call me Hot Lips.
Now, swallowing flamesicles is a real crowd pleaser. But what people really come for from near and far is, well, pretty much what you might see at a big circus, only way more up close and personal. Way more.
People really like the big cats for some reason. I guess because they're dangerous. You know? That's like a car race. Somebody gets killed and all smashed to heck, cars all busted. Boy, that was great, wasn't it?
Well, that makes you kind of like bait standing out there, doesn't
right.
it?
Everybody asked me, why don't you carry a gun? What good does a gun do? You know, bingo, they're on you. And yeah, you know, the lion and tiger training is. Well, put it this way, there isn't too many dumb enough to go in with.
After that little fence incident, I'd be happy to leave the profession to Wilbert. Paying my respects to a tamer bunch on the way out and checking to make sure all my digits are still intact. Now, if this rain would just ease up, we might be able to ease some tension with a quick game of catch. Randy says he knows just the place, one of those power spots where latitude and longitude come together in a meaningful way, outside some small town with a very strange name, which coincidentally, Lou and Peter Berryman, Wisconsin's favorite folk singers, have written a quirky little tune about.
A quarter of the way from top to bottom of our earth, a quarter of the way around the planet of our birth. Speaking cartographically, it's not extreme to say it's the most important Topski in the USA.
Poniatowski! Poniatowski!
Not Milwaukee.
Poniatowski. It's raining.
They gotta get the tarp on this one.
Yeah.
Game called on account of rain.
Game called. It's over.
Let's go.
Oh well, we'll have to try it again later, which will be okay because at least we brought snacks and at least they don't taste like those pitchers of chips we had back in Iowa.
We'll just throw that on the floor in the van like everything else.
We gotta get a bigger vehicle.
We've got just one last stop to make, and it's in Phillips, home of a couple more of Wisconsin's more offbeat attractions. One is the museum bar where a world-class taxidermist apparently did a whole lot of recreational mounting, which explains why Mike is our natural choice to check it out.
That was cool. That was the best. That was the best.
Guess we'll just have to wander. And speaking of wander, back on the other side of town sits one of those sites we see as granddaddies of grassroots art, the Wisconsin Concrete Park. Here in his yard, Fred Smith proved once again how the urge to create is not constrained by a lack of formal training.
He was a logger, you know, a lumberjack. He was a farmer. He was a bartender. He owned his own tavern. He had all the bottles handy, and of course some of them broke. And like most people who grew up during the Depression, you save everything. You know, you might find a use for it. And he certainly saved a lot of stuff. He was 63 years old when he started this. He was just sitting there, he said, looking out the window, and all of a sudden he could visualize seeing things. And it just amazed him so much that he couldn't stop doing it. You know, it was so exciting to him to see these people come alive again. This is Everson, and he lived in the area and he delivered gas. This is truly, you know, a portrait. This is Mr. Knox, and these are his oxen. This is Mabel, and she's the milkmaid, and she's milking the cow. And look at the big smile on this cow's face. You're like, ooh, and even the eyes are kind of slanted, like, oh, this is good.
Fred's work really expresses so much about his life, his time, the people that lived there, the landscape and the history. And the figures really look like the people that are up there. It was very heavily settled by Czechoslovakian and Bohemian immigrants, and you know, really strong facial characteristics that Fred really expressed.
Somebody bet him he couldn't do a person, you know, standing on a marble. He did. He said, nobody told me how big that marble had to be. They were all gathered around in the bar, you know, and they were telling their fish stories about how big the muskie was that they caught. And Fred says, oh, wait a minute. At Sioux Lake, I caught this muskie that was so big I had to go get a farmer's horse team to haul it out of the water. He loved the movies, and he was always looking through newspapers and magazines. He was always up to date on anything that was going on. He just was so thrilled with that movie, he just had to have a Ben-Hur. And he rigged it out. He has a spiritual side too. We have an angel with a woman who is offering flowers.
How was he received at the time though by the community?
They thought he was crazy. He was eccentric, we all admit that, but they thought that it was absolutely ridiculous. You know, this is stupid to me. Animals and people out of rocks and concrete, you know, what good is that? And a lot of people talked about bulldozing it down. And we were so glad they never followed through with any of those ideas.
Fred said, actually, people were constantly saying, Mr. Smith, why are you doing this? What makes you do this? And there are recorded a number of quotes. One of them is, I don't know, it might be something you seen or you did or you heard. So what he meant is, you know, you just see something that you hear as an artist and it makes an impression on you, and then you carry it with you your whole life, and then you pick up some stuff and you make it, which he did over and over and over again.
Well, the more successful you are, the more you get hung up on what who you are, I think, you know. And this guy never had any doubts of who he was. He was just out doing it. He was a guy in the woods.
And he wouldn't let any of his sculpture pieces go. People offered him lots of money for quite a few things, including that big moose that we saw, you know. And he wouldn't do that. He wouldn't even go there and build it for them. But when I met him, he was standing at a 45-degree angle already and walking with a cane. Here I was, just a young girl from the city, going, man, how'd you do this? I just can't believe you did this.
And his answer was?
And his answer was, it's got to be in you to do it, you know? He did it for all the American people, and he wanted everybody to see it. And he wanted everybody to know that what was part of his life, I think, and the things that impressed him.
Fred did insist on using his own concrete, which he made with his own unwashed sand, which accounts for some of the crumbling. And back in the 70s, a big windstorm really rocked this place, making it all the more amazing that it's still here to see and share with some of the biggest mosquitoes known to man. And best of all, I think that game of catch might finally be calling. So from here in the Land O' Lakes, this would be Don the Camera Guy, signing off.
I think we better go sit down over there.
Can you believe they're paying us to do this?
What can you get from all these mosquito bites?
Well, let's see. Typhoid fever is carried, malaria is carried by mosquitoes.
Encephalitis.
Oh, that's a big one.
Bad reception.
Yeah. I don't think that's it. Meningitis.
Huh.
Meningitis.
Got that to look forward to.
Yeah. Maybe they're not paying us enough to do this.
Can you believe they're not paying us enough to do this?
Now, is it just my imagination, or are those the credits going across here?
I think you're seeing that.
Look, there's Nakona.
There's Nakona.
He's the best boy. That's pretty
good. Magic of TV.
Well, I hope we got everybody on there that has to be.
I hope we didn't forget anyone.
I hate that.
Production costs for Rare Visions and Roadside Revelations have been paid for in part by Sprint, committed to the community, connecting you to the world.
To learn more about the sites you've seen on this program, you can order the companion book to the series Rare Visions and Roadside Revelations by calling the number on your screen.